The second Samuel, which we're in today. And I just want to go over some of the things that have happened to lead up to this. And we're going to start in the scriptures in, even though I'm going to be in 1 Samuel 12, I'm going to read some scriptures in the previous chapters to, that leads up to where we're going to be studying today. Okay? And what happened in the history of Israel is that God was in control of everything that happened civilly, you know, through the civil law, through the ceremonial law, through the moral law, and God was guiding them all the way. And then at a certain time, which we're looking at today, Israel demanded a king. And was it a good thing? Was it a bad thing? But we'll read about it. Because it's not necessarily a bad thing if we're trusting the Lord every step of the way, including those in leadership. Okay? And so, and it came about when Samuel was old, and we're in 1 Samuel 8:1. Now, it came about when Samuel was old that he appointed his sons judges over Israel. Now, the name of his firstborn was Joel, and the second, and the name of the second, Abiah, and they were judging, and Beersheba, and his sons, however, did not walk in his ways. You know what? Even Samuel. He had teenagers. Yeah.
But I was thinking about that. They probably influenced by Elijah's sons.
Yeah.
Sometimes our children can be influenced by outside.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, all over. And we're going to find out why they wanted a king, too. Right. And so, however, his sons did not walk in his ways, but turned aside after dishonest gain, thinking about Dr. Stanley's sermon this morning, you know, and took bribes and perverted justice. So not only were the judges, see, people say don't judge one another. There's a whole book of judges, for goodness sake. You know? And you can judge righteously, okay? And took bribes and perverted justice. And, you know, so even judges were, you know, appointed as rulers in God's behalf, God's way, you know. And then all the leaders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel. And they said to him, "Behold, you have grown old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint a king for us to judge us like all the nations." So I just want to point out this verse over here. Give a king to us, you know. Behold, you have grown old, your sons don't walk in your ways. So here's our excuse now. Appoint a king for us, because surely a king or a president or whatever monarch wouldn't walk away from God, would they?
Never.
And so the thing was displeasing in the sight of Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to judge us." And Samuel prayed to the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Listen to the voices of the people in regard to all that they say to you." Sometimes God gives us what we ask for. To, you know, to teach us. You know? What a lesson. And anyway, but you have not rejected, but they have rejected me from being king over them. Okay, they haven't rejected you, but they have rejected, capital me, God, me, from being king over them. And like all the deeds which they have done since that day, I brought them up from Egypt, even to this day, and that they have forsaken me when I brought them out of Egypt. They have forsaken me. They served other gods. Where do you think the influence of the other gods came from?
Egypt.
And anywhere, you know, the influence. So they are doing, but you're right. And so they are voting, so they are doing to you also. Now then, listen to their voice, however, and you shall solemnly warn them and tell them of the procedure of the king who will reign over them. And so then, this was the warning. So Samuel spoke all these words of the Lord to the people who had asked of a king. Yeah. And he said, "This will be the procedure of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and place them for himself in his chariots and among his horsemen, and they will run before his chariots, and he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and of fifties, and some do this in his plowing and to reap his harvest and to make his weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. And they will take daughters as perfumers and cooks and bakers, and he will take the rest of the field and your vineyards and your olive groves and all of that. And he goes on and on, you know. He will take a tenth of your seed and of your vineyards and give to his officers and of his servants. And, you know, because this is what happened when people wanted to ruler over them. You're going to have to pay him, right? And all his people. And he will also take your male servants and your female servants and your best men and your donkeys and use them for his work. And by the way, you wanted a king, right? Okay, well, this is how we're going to do it. And he will take a tenth of your flocks, and you yourself will become his servants. And then you will cry out in that day because of your king whom you have chosen for yourself, but the Lord will not answer you in that day because this is what you wanted. Okay, you with me?
Yes.
Nevertheless, the people refused to listen to the voice of Samuel after he said, this is what's going to happen. But no, there shall be a king over us, they said. Mm-hmm. And they will also be like all the nations. So, that we may all be like all the nations. Now, think in your mind, there was one nation that was ruled by God, and if you're not ruled by God, what do you think is happening in all the other nations? What is happening? Say what?
It doesn't have God.
It doesn't have God. What happens when you don't have
God? Chaos.
That's right. Lots of stuff. Immorality, you name it. Yeah, we'll and they said, and the Lord said to Samuel, listen to their voice and appoint them a king. So Samuel said to the men of Israel, go every man to his city. Okay? Now, let me see if I can do this. Yeah. So we're doing this real fast. Saul's search. Okay, now, there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Abiel, the son of Zeror, and the son of Korath, and the son of whatever his name is, and the son of Benjamite. Whenever I was reading the Bible with my sons and we came across words like that, they just go, blah, 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 you know. And a man of valor. And he had a son whose name was Saul. Now, who was the first king of Israel?
Saul.
And a choice of handsome man. Yes. And there was not a more handsome person than among the sons of Israel. From his shoulders and up, he was taller than any other people.
Hollywood.
There. And now the donkeys of Kish, Saul's father, were lost. Okay? So Kish said to the son of Saul, now take one of your servants, arise, go search for the donkeys, missing donkeys, right? And he passed through the hill country of Ephraim and passed through the land of and but did not find him. And they passed through the land of Shalim, but they were not there. Then he passed through the land of Benjamites, and they did not find them. They're looking for donkeys, okay? And when they came to the land of Zuph, Saul said to his servant who was with him, come, let us return, or else my father will cease to be concerned about the donkeys and will become anxious for us. See, God could use anything, and he even could use an ass and something like this. But he said to them, behold, now there's a man of God in the city, and the man is held in honor, and all that he says surely shall come true. Now let's go there, and perhaps he can tell us about the journey which we have set out. And then Saul said to his servant, behold, if we go, what would you bring the man? So they tried to say, let's bring him something, you know what? And formerly in Israel, when a man went to inquire of God, he used to say, come, let us go to the seer. And the seer is called a prophet, you know, now. It was formerly called a seer. So they went to see a seer. Okay, then Saul, they went to see a seer. Then Saul said to his servants, well said, let us go. So they went to the city where there was a man of God. And they went up the slope to the city. They found young women going out to draw water and said to them, is the seer here? And they answered, and he said, he is. He is ahead of you. Hurry now, for he has come into the city today, for the people had a sacrifice on the high place. And it's as soon as you enter the city, you will find him before he goes up to the high place to eat, and the people will not eat, and da 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 da. And then, so they went up, and as they came to the city, I'm over here, behold, Samuel, the seer, Samuel the seer, they went to see, was coming out toward them to go up to the high place. Now, a day before Saul's coming, the Lord had revealed then to Samuel, saying, about this time tomorrow, I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin. You shall anoint him to be prince over my people Israel, and he will deliver my people from the hand of the Philistines. And for I have regarded my people because their cry has come up to me. And when Samuel, there's all these S's, when the seer Samuel saw, the Lord said to him, behold, the man of whom I spoke to you, this one shall rule over my people. Okay, so here it is. Then Saul approached Samuel in the gate, and please tell me where the seer's house is. And Samuel answered Saul, and said, I'm the seer. I'm sorry, I'm the seer. And then, go up before me to the high place, and you shall eat with me today, and in the morning I will, you know, let you go, and tell you what is on your mind. And as for your donkeys, which were lost 3 days ago, do not set your mind on them, for they've been found. So we knew all about that because God revealed it to him. Mm-hmm. For whom is all that is desirable in all Israel? Is it for you and for your father's household? Saul replied, am I not a Benjamin of the smallest tribes of Israel, and my family, the least of all the families of the tribe of Benjamin? Why then do you speak to me this way? Then Samuel took Saul and his servant and brought them to the hall and gave them a place at the head of those who were invited. They were important people, and there were about 30 men there. And Samuel said to the cook, bring the portion that I gave you. And the cook, took up the leg, with your big thing, this is for you, Saul. And Samuel said, here is what has been reserved. Set it before you, and because it's been kept for you, a big royal thing for him. So all ate, with Samuel that day. And then when they came down from the high place, Samuel spoke with Saul on the roof, and they arose early, and at daybreak Samuel called to Saul on the roof, saying, get up, that I may send you away. So Saul arose, and both he and Samuel went to the house, and they are going down to the city, and Samuel said to Saul, say to the servants, that he might go ahead of us and pass, on, and da da da. Okay, so later, okay, we're getting there. Okay, Saul among the prophets, Samuel took the flask of oil, poured it on his head, kissed him, and said, has not the Lord anointed you a ruler over his inheritance? This was a big thing. The Lord of heaven and earth. And I always go back to the beginning of time. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, then, God made man and woman. In the beginning, then, people multiplied, but God always intervened with his creation. And on it went. And then Israel came about, and God, through that little tiny nation, was going to be the example for the rest of the world. You with me? Now, can you imagine Saul saying, the Lord anointed you a ruler over his inheritance? This is huge. What a mighty, mighty responsibility. Okay? And when you go from me today, then you will find two men close to Rachel's tomb in the territory of Benjamin, and they'll say to you, the donkeys which you have went to look for have been found. Okay, good sign from the Lord. Everything is going to fall into place. This is little things. God gives us little things in our life to let us know that he's there and he's actively involved in our life, in our lives. He does that. Don't take anything for granted. The world will tell you, oh, well, that could have happened, or these physics could happen. And I don't know why there were floods, in Virginia or this and that, but everything is for a reason. Even when you're looking for something, like your keys, and you find them, thank God.
Amen.
He gave you the breath to do it. He gave you the eyes to look for it. He gave it to you, okay? He's concerned. Okay, Now, behold, your father has ceased to be concerned about the donkeys and is anxious for you, saying, what shall I do about my son? Then you will go further from there, and you will come to the oak of Tabor, and all these little intricate things is what's going to happen. And then the Philistines and all that, then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you mightily, I'm in verse 6, and you shall prophesy with them and be changed into another man. And it shall be when these signs come to you, and you'll know because of these signs, I'm telling you, you know, the fear that, do for yourself what occasion requires, for God is with you. And you shall go down before me to Gilgal, and behold, I will come to you to offer burnt offerings and sacrifices, and you shall wait 7 days, and I'll come to you and show you what to do. Then it happened, he turned back to leave Samuel. And God changed his heart, and all these signs came about that day. Okay? Everything was, you know, revealed and all that stuff. And then what happened to the son of Kish? Is Saul among the prophets? And the man said, no. Now, who is their father? And therefore, it became a prophet. Is Saul also among the people? Okay. Now Saul's uncle said to him, the servant, where did you go? And, you know, he got the donkeys. And then comes Saul, publicly chosen king. Thereafter, Samuel called the people together for the Lord at Mizpah. And he said to the sons of Israel, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel. Because this is the seer talking. When the prophet is talking, thus saith the Lord. And Samuel was a good guy. He was a good prophet.
That's George.
Yeah. And thus say the Lord, the God of Israel, I brought Israel up from Egypt, and I delivered you from the hand of the Egyptians and from the power of all the kingdoms that were oppressing you. This is what God did, right?
Yes.
He laid it out. This is your history. 19. But you have today rejected your God who delivered you, who delivers you from all of your calamities and your distresses. Yet you have said no to the God of the universe who created everything and intervened in the lives of his creation. And there was no way that the Israels were going to get out of Egypt, but God got them out of Egypt. And God brought them along the way through the wilderness. And then God raised them up, but you have rejected your God who delivers you from all your calamities and your distresses, yet you have said, no, but set a king over us. Now therefore present yourself before the Lord by your tribes and by your clans, because you didn't get what you asked for. Thus Samuel brought all the tribes of Israel near. Oh, by the way, what I'm telling you here has been happening in history all over the world, except for Israel, until that time. And now they're going to get what they want because everybody else had one. Okay? And then Samuel brought all the tribes of Israel near, and all the tribes of Israel was taken by Lot. And they brought the tribes of Benjamin near by his families, and the Mite family was taken, and Saul, the sons of Kish, was taken. But when they looked for him, he could not be found. Therefore, they inquired further of the Lord, has the man come here yet? So the Lord said, behold, he is hiding himself by the baggage door. This guy that I'm going to tell you right now. He's hiding. Okay. So they ran and took him from there. Could you imagine that? Get over here. Get over here. So all the people shouted and said, long live the king. So they ran and took him from there. When he stood among the people, he was taller than any of the people from his shoulders up. And Samuel said to all the people, do you see him who the Lord has chosen? Surely there is none like him among all the people. So all the people shouted and said, long live the king. And then Samuel told the people the ordinances of the kingdom, wrote them in the book. This is very important. I'm going to just look at that. Samuel told the people the ordinances of the kingdom, wrote them down in a book, and placed it before the Lord. And Samuel sent all the people away, each one to his house. Saul also went to his house at Gibeah, and the valiant man whose heart God had touched went there. But certain worthless men said, how can this one deliver us? And they despised him and did not bring him in present, but kept silent. Okay, got that. 11, before we go into 12, and sorry, Brian, if I went over any of your stuff that you did last time, but we're just doing a recap.
Can I ask a really quick question?
Okay.
Over and over again, it says that Saul was taller than them from the shoulders up.
Yeah.
Isn't that kind of bizarre?
Well, he was tall.
Okay, so that's just, it's just a weird way of saying it.
Yeah,
like
he was head and shoulders. He was head and shoulders above the rest.
Okay.
They have a shampoo about
that. You know
that.
What I was saying?
Yeah. All right. Okay. Then Saul defeats the Ammonites. Got it. Now Nahash, the Ammonite, came up and besieged Jabesh Gilead, and all the men of Jabesh said to Nahash,
yeah,
make a covenant with us and we will serve you. But Nahash the Ammonite said to them, I will make it with you on this condition, that I will gouge out the right eye of every one of you, and thus I will make it a reproach to all Israel. And the elders of Gilash said to him, let us alone for 7 days that we may send messengers throughout the territory of Israel. Then, if there is no one to deliver us, we will come out to you. And then the messengers came to Jabesh of Saul and spoke these words in the hearing of the people, and the people lifted up their voices and wept, because that was a big fish over there. I'm going to gouge out your eyes. So behold, Saul coming up from the field behind the oxen, and said to them, what's the matter with these people that they weep so overlaid? And the words of the men of Jabesh. And then the Spirit of God came upon Saul mightily when he heard these words, and he became very angry, and he took a yoke of oxen, cut them into pieces, sent them to the territory of Israel by the hands of the messengers, saying, whoever does not come out after Saul and after Samuel, so it shall be done to his oxen. Then the dread of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out as one man, and he numbered them in, what is it, Bezek? And then the sons of Israel were 300,000, and the men of Judah were 30,000. And they said to the messengers who had come, thou shalt say to the men of Jabesh Gilead, tomorrow by this time the sun is hot, you will have deliverance. So pretty early in the day. So the messengers went and told the men of Jabesh, and they were glad. And the men of Jabesh said, tomorrow we will come out to you, and you may do to us whatever seems good to you. And the next morning, Saul put the people in three companies, and they came into the midst of the camp in the morning watch and struck down the Ammonites until the end of the day. And those who survived were scattered, so that no two of them were left together. The people said to Samuel, who is this that said, shall Saul reign over us? Bring the men that we may put them to death. But Saul said, no. Not a man shall be put to death on this day, for today the Lord has accomplished deliverance in Israel. Great! That's what he was giving glory to God. And then Samuel said to the people, come and let us go to Gilgal and renew the kingdom there. So all the people went to Gilgal, and they made Saul king before the Lord in Gilgal. And they also offered sacrifices of peace offerings before the Lord. And there Saul and all the people of Israel rejoiced greatly. Now we're starting the lesson. Okay? We just wanted to grasp this, that the people asked for a king because that's what everybody else would do. All right? Now, okay. This is the lesson that we're intertwining here from Lifeway. What were you afraid of as a child?
Dark.
The dark. Okay. Yeah?
My parents.
Your parents. Okay. A good healthy fear? Okay. Yeah?
You can call it that.
Yeah, if you could call it that. I mean, some people, they got beaten up by their parents, you know? There was abuse and stuff. And what is fear good?
When it keeps you out of trouble.
When it keeps you out, when you learn from something? Absolutely. Okay? And then fear can be good when it keeps us from doing something reckless or dangerous, right? And then fear can be bad when it keeps us from taking on new responsibilities, just stepping out of our comfort zone. Now, has anybody been asked to step out of their comfort zone?
Yes.
When? Now, yes. Yes, Karen's going to start his new job, and she's going to be with us for a couple more weeks, and then She's off to a new church. Administrator. Isn't that good? Ever since we've been praying about it, since experiencing God and all that?
Yes.
Okay. When others, I mean, mine was, maybe Roberta, I became a Christian. I had to step out of my comfort zone, even though I knew my parents were going to disown me. And that's what happened. But then you do something like that, and God honors it, and both my parents came to know the Lord.
Amen.
Praise God.
So, you never know.
Wow.
So, it could be bad if anybody else stepped out of their comfort zone. Anytime. Yes.
Well, I haven't yet, but I know God has called me to do something. He spoke to me about my future.
Okay.
And I would definitely be stepping out of my comfort
zone. Yeah, that's a big thing. I stepped out of my comfort zone again when I had kids. Kids, tough.
Everybody steps out.
I mean, just yesterday. Oh, I can tell you. Oh, it was horrible. Now we're going home to see my brother, who has congestive heart failure, the lymphoma, but he has got a pacemaker and a defibrillator inside of him. He just broke his hip. And, you know, God's getting to the end of himself. And he said to me one night, I was pulling him off the toilet seat because he fell back. And I told his daughter to bring a booster seat with arms on it so he could lift himself up. But, you know, he said, don't get old. I said, I'm just a year and a half younger than you are. But I knew what he was saying, you know, and he said, don't get old. But then I was saying, when I was praying with him before I left the Holy Land, Puerto Rico, Florida, it's all good. I said to him, there's something more important than getting old, it's your salvation.
Amen.
Okay, look into that. And so he said, okay. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I also just say how,
you were to fear God. And you, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
And then what else are you saying is how
you will lose friends doing that. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, you have done that? Oh. Yes. Yes.
But the thing is,
did you hear her?
No.
Okay. Yeah,
it's
right here.
Okay, this girl.
Yeah, there you go.
Allison, she was my best friend. And into the New Age. Because before I went into the New Age, but before I was in a next in a while. But I have a head injury, I forget, but I don't remember that. But when it comes back, I just say, Satan, get out of here. My sense went back.
So everybody's going through something. We step out of our comfort zones. You know, we're trusting God to go into a new direction. In today's study, we're going to discuss God's character and the place fear has in our relationship with Him. Fear can be a good thing. Okay? Who Jesus, right? Now, we're going to start with 1 Samuel 12. This is our lesson today. Then Samuel said to all Israel, behold, I have listened to your voice, and that all you said to me, and I have appointed a king over you. Now, here is the king walking before you, but I'm old, Samuel said, and gray, and behold, my sons are with you, and I have walked before you from my youth even to this day. Here I am, bear witness against me before the Lord and his anointed. Whose ox have I taken? Or whose donkey have I taken? Or whom have I defrauded? Whom have I oppressed? Or from whose land have I taken a bribe to blind my eyes with it? I will restore you. You know? But you know what? That was a rhetorical question. He was a man of honor. Okay? He was a godly man. And they said, you have not defrauded us or oppressed us or taken anything from any man's hands. And he said to them, the Lord is witness against you, and his anointed is witness this day that you found nothing in my hand. And they said, he is witness. Okay? And then, wait, let me go back up here. Let me see if I did this right. Okay. Oh. Okay. Then Samuel said to the people, "It is the Lord who appointed Moses and Aaron, and who brought your fathers up from the land of Egypt." Were they kings? Yeah.
No, there's great men.
Great men.
God.
Right.
Great men.
So now take your stand, that I may plead with you before the Lord concerning all the righteous acts of the Lord which he did for you and your fathers. And so he does a little snippet of eternity past, the history of Israel. And when Jacob went into Egypt, and your fathers cried out to the Lord, then the Lord sent Moses and Aaron, who brought your fathers out of Egypt and settled them in this place. But they forgot the Lord, their God. So he sold them into the land of Sisera, and captain of the army of Hazor, and into the land of the Philistines, and into the land of the king of Moab, and they fought against them. And they cried out to the Lord and said, "We have sinned because we have forsaken the Lord and have served the Baals and the Asherah." This is what other nations were doing. "But now deliver us from the hands of our enemies and we will serve you." This is what Israel was crying out then, and history is now repeating itself, though. And then the Lord said, "Send Jerubbaal and Japheth and Samuel, and deliver you from the hands of your enemies all around, so that you live in security." And then the kings confirmed, "When you saw that Nahash, the king of the sons of Ammon, came against you, you said to me, 'No, but a king shall reign over us.' And although the Lord your God was your king," in other words, you had a king, you want something else. "Now therefore, here is the king whom you have chosen, whom you have asked for, and behold, the Lord has sent a king over you. If you fear the Lord," listen to this, "if you fear the Lord and serve him and listen to his voice, and not rebel against the command of the Lord." If you fear the Lord and you serve him and listen to his voice and not rebel against, like, the command of the Lord, if you will not listen to the voice of the Lord but rebel against the command of the Lord, then the hand of the Lord will be against you as it was your father's. So really, nothing's changed if you do it this way. "And even now, take your stand and see this great thing which the Lord, you know, will do before you your eyes. Is it not the wheat harvest?" It was about Pentecost, about May, okay? "Is it not the wheat harvest today? I will call to the Lord that he may send thunder and rain." Now, this is, if you live in Israel, you'll know that it doesn't rain this time of year.
Yes.
The first time I went to Israel, I got on a plane and I took an umbrella and I had it in my, you know, right next to me and on the plane, and two Israeli guys said, "You won't need that." And I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "It doesn't rain here at this time." And it was just a given. It just doesn't. They have rainy seasons and stuff like that, but not. I mean, so when I went with Chris to Israel, I didn't bring an umbrella, and we didn't need it. Did it rain?
Never.
Never. Okay. "Is it not the wheat harvest? I will call to the Lord that he may send thunder and rain." And the people are going, "Yeah, right." "Then you will know and see that your wickedness is great, which you have done in the sight of the Lord by asking for yourselves a king." So Samuel called to the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain that day. And all the people greatly feared the Lord and Samuel. And Then all the people said to Samuel, pray, pray for your servants to the Lord your God that we may not die. For we have added to all our sins this evil by asking for ourselves a king. This is where a healthy country should be. Samuel said to the people, do not fear. You have committed all this evil, yet do not turn aside from following the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart. You must not turn aside, for then you will go after futile things which cannot profit or deliver because they are futile. For the Lord will not abandon his people on account of his great name, because the Lord has been pleased to make you a people for himself. You know, God is not over with Israel. And just because they ask for a king, if they continue to do the Lord, you know, the Lord, observe it and stuff, great. Good things will happen. God gave them what they wanted. They wanted to go over, you know, after other things that other countries were doing because they didn't want to fear the Lord. But now he's saying over here, I was pleased to make you my people. I had a covenant with you. I don't go back on my covenant, but I'm going to discipline my kids. Okay? Moreover, as for me, far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by ceasing to pray for you. Oh, I hope that's our prayer for everybody in here. But I will instruct you in the good and right way. Only fear the Lord, serve him in truth with all your heart, for consider what great things he has done for you. But if you still do wickedly, you know, both you and your king will be swept away. Your choice, what do you want to do? I'm thinking about Dr. Stanley's sermon. So, we got this. You know what? They asked for, you have asked for, you know, our lesson day starts in 12:12. When you saw that Nahash, the king of the sons of Ammon, came against you, you said to me, but his king shall reign over us, although the Lord your God was your king. Now therefore, here is the king you have chosen, you have asked for, behold, the Lord has said, king over you, if you fear. But even though you ask for the king, if you fear the Lord, you serve him, listen to the Lord's voice, and not rebel against the command of the Lord, then both you and your king who reigns over you will follow the Lord your God. But if you will not listen to the voice of the Lord, but rebel against the command, then the Lord will be against you. Okay? What was Israel's request? Why was Israel's request to have a king sinful?
A king what they can see, like the other nation. They can see God, so we want a king that we can see.
Absolutely.
And God gave him that. Which this man, to me, as I have read out this chapter, this man was not saved. I don't think so.
Okay. Okay.
They didn't wait for God's will.
They didn't wait for God's will. But they wanted to do things like other countries.
Yes.
Okay. Sound familiar?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. In pressing Samuel to find them a king, so they could be like the people around them, the Israelites were rejecting God as their king. Yes. It happened, folks.
Still do.
Huh?
And
still do.
But what Saul was doing, Saul was acting like a paper doll king, because when we read it back up, going back a little bit, and he was hiding. A king don't do that. When you're ready to shine and God give you opportunity, you step up to the plate.
Yeah, but God used it. And he was ahead.
Yeah.
Head and the shoulders bigger than everybody else. And they go, yeah, that's the guy.
Yeah. He was handsome. And
yeah. Looking. That's right.
And they said, taller than anybody else, above the shoulder. And
yeah.
He said, yeah, this is the one.
This must be the man.
This is
the man. Would somebody have their hand up? Yes.
I see a lot of references to drought. Dr. Stanley quoted today. So my question is, and this was on my mind all week too, you know, we're having all these problems in the United States with drought, and could this possibly be the same thing that we've seen in the Bible?
It could possibly be that. You know, I want to do this. I'm just a man delivering a message. However, stuff is happening.
Right.
And if you say this to an atheist, though, they'll go, well, how do you know it's just not the world? You know, it's climate change.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, but never underestimate that should be bring something up like this. So, yeah. Okay, and so, impressing Samuel to find them a king so they could be like the people living around them, the Israelites were rejecting God as their king. Now, what are we doing teaching our kids the way they should go? Now, I mean, this is happening. This is happening just the other day. You know, this is happening. That was a gay pride in New York. And you know what? Just do it. You know, I don't know about you, but I'm looking at commandment number 7 over there. You shall not commit adultery. And Jesus said, you know, even if you look at a woman or a man to lust after them, you've committed adultery with your heart in your heart. And you know what? People say, I'm sure they're saying, well, I want to get married. I'll just get married.
To who?
Right. Who? The bottom line is, you could rationalize anything, but look at this little boy.
I know.
We do. It's not the way it is now. This is what we're teaching our new generation and the things to come. I mean, years ago, Kennedy got a man on the moon. Now with our president today, we put a man in the bathroom.
Yes.
Here's a, you know what? Something's going on here. And this is what's being taught. We're supposed to instruct our kids the way they should go so they won't depart from it. Do you think this is acceptable in God's eyes?
No.
But what if you have the world say to you, just do what you feel like you are. And you know what? I'm not going into the, there's things like people are born, what is it, hermaphrodite or whatever. What is it as God, you know, he meant man and woman. And I know sin has entered into the world, the death of sin and all sorts of things happen. But this is what we're teaching our kids.
And this is the world's way.
And this is the world's way.
And not God's way, like you said.
Is it a boy or a girl? Oh, don't be a bigot.
Where is it that somewhere they just had, where they issued driver's licenses?
Yeah.
Driver's licenses of no gender.
There's no gender. Yeah.
They have a picture board instead of they have a female.
What was that, Roberta?
Instead of like, you know, have female and male,
yeah.
It's going to have an X.
Where's X mean?
You have you all just decided.
Oh, you haven't decided yet.
Yeah.
Okay. You know what? If you go and do things apart from the Lord, then all and this is becoming closer and closer, and then all of a sudden, you know, poof, it's in your face. This has been going on for a long time, and you know, it's wrong. It's not healthy. It's not godly. But we want to be like other nations. Yeah.
Although, I actually feel you as pushing this world, same-sex marriage idea, Jesus out of the world, but that's not the state. So, my old pastor once said, wherever there's chaos, there's confusion.
Oh, yeah.
This notion that we're nothing, we're not a gender,
yes,
we're not a man or a woman, that's total confusion. So, that's evil.
Right.
And I walk my dog, thank you, Jesus, sometimes like a shepherd, on a trail in a park every day. I miss my dog for 2 years.
Yeah.
Yesterday I encountered a guy, I think, for less clothes, not very much. And he was saying he was meeting this other dog walker that I could tell by the car was in the park. But when I caught up to them, thank you, I said, man, they're walking. You know, he was introducing this guy to the guy. I said, oh, I hope you don't mind. You know, I'm going to do this. I like to run around too.
In a public place?
In a public park. Who talks like that?
Has
Dr. Stanley was pointing out, you know, over-sexualized the world.
Oh, it is. And you know what? It's not like if somebody's doing that behind closed doors, let them back. I don't care what they're doing. doing behind closed doors. No, but you know what? I'm going to say something. Because we need to be lights and solar ambassadors for Christ.
The fire and fire will close, and I will call the police.
Well, yeah.
But then the police will come and probably shoot him, and then it's a whole other thing.
But I just want to be like other nations.
Well, no, I told this class when I got here about something like mascara, okay, at a high-end retail store. I went in there on a Saturday, and a lady was in there with a see-through bra on, no shirt on. And I called the security and the police and everybody, and the security ended up mad at me and says she's allowed to express herself, and mom was doing it.
You hear that? You're allowed to express your...
Yeah, she had on a see-through bra.
Now you're a bigot if you don't.
She didn't have it on shirt at all.
On the dog walker, that's what he said.
But you see, Satan working.
But I would mind.
You know, you see how Satan works suddenly and all of a sudden in your face.
That's right.
And this is because people, you know, Samuel, this is where it's revealed to us. God knows the history from cover to cover, but this is revealed to us now what happened. And the reason that we read the scriptures, it says these things were, somebody read Romans 15:4.
We are present tense participants.
Yes. Who has Romans 15:4, and just say it out loud.
I don't want to cut across here. Go on.
Okay, what is it?
For whatever things were written before were written for our learning.
So whatever things were written before, like for Samuel, yeah, were written for our learning.
That we, through the patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope.
So that we, through the scriptures, the comfort of scriptures, we might have hope. And if we don't follow the scriptures, and we don't follow God's history, you know, just because you have the Old Testament, don't say, oh, that was just for the Jewish people. No, these things were written for our instruction.
And just like you just said, that scripture, but it's almost saying like Jeremiah 29:11.
Yeah.
I know the plans that I have for you, not for calamity, bad, but for good plan for your welfare.
He wants the good plan.
Hope.
And a hope. And people will say, well, that was written for Israel. No, it was written in the past for our instruction and our comfort and our hope. You know? And so, anyway, what, did somebody else have it? Yes.
Well, I was going to say, when you look at this stuff, it's almost like you can't even be surprised, you know, because the word says, that in Romans, their minds was darkened because you refused to acknowledge me.
That's it. Romans 1, starting in 18.
Are darkened in the way of their thinking.
Yeah.
So what do you expect when people don't have Christ in their life?
Right. Oh yeah.
This is what you get.
This is what you get. And it's the worst of the worst, not the best of the best.
Oh, and I know how I was.
We all have the testimony.
All of us, when we didn't have Jesus in our life, just think about how you would think.
But if you're ambassadors for Christ, like the scripture says, we can say something.
Right.
It's not like, you have an agenda and you're a cultural Christian. Yes, I am a cultural Christian. I want to talk about these things.
Oh, did anybody see last week on the news that he had this event where everybody was firewalking?
Tony Robinson.
Thousands of people were firewalking, and some people got hurt. And they allowed it to continue.
50 of them went to the hospital.
It wasn't a hot thing.
Right.
Anyway,
right. See,
kind of
don't do that. And so if they would be admonished by the teachings of the Lord, they wouldn't do that. Right. Look at this.
I've said that before.
So they could be like the other people looking around, rejecting God. Look what happens when you reject God as king. This is what we're teaching the new generation. You know, the older generation will take this, but if you could do it for the newer generation, they will. And then if there's not enough of us chosen people to make a stance to say what's right and wrong, this will override the church.
What happens is saying, okay, feel love, equality, and all of this, they're taking that through is love, showing expression of we accept everybody where they are. So it's what this young lady said over there, it's like a foreign language. If someone is speaking to you and you don't understand what they're saying, you're confused, you don't know, or you have no clue. Okay? Right. It's the same thing, it's foreign language to them, knowing God or not knowing God. They don't know who Jesus is, so they don't know his word. And if you don't know his word, then you're taking it as, I don't like that you're gay, what you're doing. Or I don't like that you're killing people, and that's the way you believe in your religion, that's power and love. Instead of knowing, hey, here it is.
Yeah, and my God says, be fruitful and multiply, and if you're like this, you're going to ruin the human race.
Yeah, so that's how come, like they say, Christians that were bigoted, that were haters, and all these horrible things, and then they shout louder than we do, because we're looking and say, okay, you know, we love you. God doesn't like the sin. He doesn't like our sin either, whether we overeat, or whether we curse, or whatever we do. He doesn't like any of that. But we see this. Sin you see at home by yourself,
right?
But other people may not get to see that
part. And like I said to my brother, the greatest thing is not so much that we're getting older, it's our salvation.
Right. Also, I'm sorry. Ultimately, they don't want to face their sin.
Right, they don't know.
Because if it feels good, do it. That's there, but not denying yourself, you know. We are embracing the cross where Jesus suffered and died. And you know what he suffered and died for? Sin.
Yes.
We're all given that conscience, okay?
Yeah.
The way the master, okay. And everybody's supposed to be aware. Now I remember when I wasn't saved, you know. And I remember how I lived. I think, you know, did I have conscience then? Did I really know right from wrong? Was this wrong then? Okay, how'd I know? Some things I recognized, some things I didn't, because when you're going with people who are doing the same thing as you have been doing,
your conscience gets seared.
That's right. And so you don't have no more feeling. It's just kind of like living in this world now. If you become immune to all of this, you're not holding up to God's word.
One atheist said to me online, they said, oh, you heard God's voice? What did it sound like? Like, I have a mental disorder. And I turned it around and said, I hear him the same way you hear him. You have a conscience.
Right, thank you.
You believe that fornication is right or wrong. Where are you getting that from? Where do you think good and evil? Your conscience is God's voice to you right now. And so, you hear God's voice? Yeah, you know, open the scriptures, look at the Ten Commandments.
She said, they do have a conscience. That's
they do.
So many years they hid it.
They do.
Their conscience tell them that it was wrong.
And that's why we teach Way of the Master, to touch on the conscience and let people understand that there is right and wrong. Yeah.
What's really bad is being around some other Christian people, it could be at work, or just outside, somewhere. And they're Christians, and I'm nobody to judge that. They say they are. I go by that. But you see some light, or you see all darkness, or a little speck of light, whatever. But it's interesting to me that when we have a conversation, and if we're talking about equality, or gay, or how people live their lives, or losing it up, if I say something, it's amazing how they'll think I'm prejudiced, and
you're
judging. And judge. Right. You're not supposed to.
When their
to
conscience
judge.
Is telling them the same
and
thing that they don't want to hear.
Find that verse in the Bible says that you shouldn't judge. No, that's not what God means.
No.
God does not
There's
tell
There's a whole book of judges. Hello.
We are to judge, but it's different.
Righteousness.
Yes, righteousness.
Right.
so cautious.
Wow, it's really
Yeah.
It's almost as if everything is good.
You can't judge by that.
It is. Woe to those who call good evil and evil good.
And you can't by that.
When she said, you don't want to judge, that's because you're justified.
And I understand that myself. I think the older that you get, the more self-awareness in your conscience is, you know. But we'll be talking about this just this morning. You become convicted.
Yeah.
And that's the whole.
And that is the whole.
We need to judge by God's word. All of this stuff is basically written in a spiritual warfare.
Oh, yeah.
All of this is nothing but stuff that gold us.
Yes.
What does the church do?
God gave us, chosen people,
but I mean, God gave us weapons to fight these battles.
That's right.
You know, that's all it is. It's a battle. But we have to fight it, you know, with the weapons that we were given. And, I mean, it's not the same thing.
That's right. Yeah, the weapons are warfare and not carnal. And Ephesians 6, you know, it's against the rulers, the authorities, the powers.
We gotta fight with what we have, just like
but we have to fight. Don't get lulled. You know, get off the phones a little bit.
Get off the phones.
Yeah. Jesus told us to break up all of them.
And what they did was they had a program for them, and I was on a prayer ministry at that time, and my director of the prayer ministry said to fast and pray, which I did not fast. I don't think none of us fast. And we did, when we got there, we couldn't get in because the musicians, they have to do something to the person, and for some reason, it wasn't done. So we were an hour behind schedule. And then when we finally got in, we normally pray before everything started. I don't even know who to do it at the time. Then when service started, I'm sitting in my chair and I had a man sitting next to me, another man sitting next to me. I am a prayer, I'm a worshiper. I always worship in that sanctuary. I could not stand up, open my mouth for nothing. And I knew in my heart that was Satan. I felt like somebody was sitting on me, holding me down. I couldn't stand up.
And he squelched the church like that.
Yeah. And I said, you know what? This is my girlfriend who was married to a homosexual. She said, that's a demon that's been around forever. He's a strong demon. It's hard to go up against.
It's Satan is Satan. Thou shalt not covet. You want to covet somebody else's body. You want to covet somebody else's pleasures. You want to covet somebody else. And then the Bible says in Romans 7:7, you know, it says, thou shalt not covet. And then it produced coveting in me at every time.
So what I'm saying is, he's a strong man.
Very.
Get around since the Old Testament.
Yes.
And you really
do have to
be afraid.
You
have
to.
You
do. Amen.
Because he got a hold on them.
Amen.
So, you've got to be prayed up.
You've got to. And this is what the church should be about. And that should be the normal Christian life. Okay. Yeah. Let's teach our new generation.
Yep.
Let's teach it. Okay. Samuel reminded the Israelites that even though God permitted them to have a human king, they were still subject to the covenants. You want to keep good, but you better keep with the scriptures.
Yes.
And they were still subject to the covenant stipulations that they were to fear, they were to worship, and obey the Lord, just like in our country. And they disobeyed God's commandments. If they did that, punishment would follow. Now, why was Israel's request to have a king sinful? The heart of the covenant relationship between God and his people is found in passages like Exodus 6 and 7. I will take you as my people, this is the covenant, and I will be your God. And the covenant did not change despite their desire for a human king. Okay? God is going to be truthful to his covenant. 1 Samuel 12, starting in 16. Even now, take your stand and see this great thing which the Lord will do before your eyes. Is it not the wheat harvest today? I will call to the Lord, and he may send thunder and rain, and then you will see that your wickedness is great, which you have done in the sight of the Lord by asking yourselves for a king. So Samuel called to the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain, and all the people greatly feared the Lord and Samuel. How did God demonstrate his power before the people?
Thunder.
Yeah.
And so
a heavenly sign. You know, I don't care if it's drought. I don't care if it's what's happening in other states even.
Fire.
Always think about what is going on.
It's happening today.
So it wasn't,
it's happening today.
It wasn't Elijah first called on the rain. It was Samuel.
Oh yeah. And there's nothing new under the sun. Okay, God sent a thunderstorm during the time of the wheat harvest when it was abnormal for the rain to occur. The storm displayed God's judgment against the people for their willful disobedience and insisting on a king. And because of the thunderstorm, the people realized they had offended God. They greatly feared him. This is where good fear is coming in. And this fear produced reverence and unease to all. And is the fear of God a positive or a negative thing?
Positive.
Good. The fear of God can involve many feelings: terror, honor, submission, dread, astonishment, and awe or reverence. Like with a boss that you're working with.
See, judgment day is going to be negative for a lot of people.
Oh, big time. Big time.
Just a quick, Paul, when they have these parades, like the one thing that I get mad at, this is like the righteous
indignation,
is when they have these parades, out here, and I say a lot of these problems are here on this level because the church isn't denying it, you know?
Yeah, that's what we're getting at. This is what this lesson is.
Okay, but why when they have these parades, why can't we organize with
churches? There is.
And get out there and praise the Lord and worship on the sidelines.
And people are doing that.
And let them keep marching.
And they get arrested.
Because they're bigots.
No, because we praising and worshiping and praying.
Disturbing the peace.
Yeah.
We're disturbing the peace.
Well, then people look at us like
it's
haters.
You know what? It's Satan. I agree with you. If you stand aside and you're fine, but you know what? People could come out with signs too, and that will make the news more than the other. But it's that type of thing where they go, the church is still alive. Yeah.
Why can't we?
We could.
Well, that's what Paul got put in jail for, all of them, because preacher the gospel, not for stealing.
The most important thing he used to tell us all the time is, if you don't stand for something,
you'll fall. Amen.
That's what happened to America today.
Yeah, that's what happened to Israel. And you know what? They were idol worshiping. They got brought into captivity. You know?
Yes.
Okay.
But just like I was saying, the battle is on our knees. It's so much right.
Well, we could get on our knees on the streets.
We could.
Why can't we do that?
We can. We
get on
the streets
on the side.
People who are enemies of God might feel terror in their, in their fear because of his unlimited knowledge and power, for God is constant and consistent in his judgment based on his righteous character. God will judge. God always will judge because he's the daddy. He's our heavenly father. And if he didn't do that, he wouldn't be doing his job.
And he's like, you have liberty to my creation.
Exactly. Yes. And he is very possessive about that. For believers, the same word fear is used to describe the proper attitude towards God. I say this on religion discussion groups. They go, you're fearful of your God? No, it's an awe. It's an awe. It's a reverence. It's a respect. And Christ has satisfied God's wrath once and for all so that we don't have fear of condemnation, but we're still accountable to a holy God.
It's okay to have that kind of fear.
Exactly. That's right. And then it says, starting in 19, then all the people said to Samuel, pray for your servants to the Lord your God so that we might not die. So they knew something. They needed an intercessor. They knew they did wrong, for we have added to all our sins this evil by asking for ourselves a king. we rejected you, God. In other words, Samuel said to the people, do not fear, you have committed all this evil, yet do not turn aside. This is all he's asking, following the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart. You must not turn, for then you would go after futile things. Are there futile things out there?
Yes.
Dr. Stanley mentioned some, which cannot profit or deliver because they're futile. For the Lord will not abandon his people on account of his great name, because the Lord has been pleased to make you a people for himself. That was his covenant. And moreover, as for me, far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by not ceasing to pray for you. So Samuel warned the people to turn away from worthless things that cannot profit. Dr. Stanley talks about people are hungry for wealth. You know? And some people are saying, I'd like to be wealthy. There's nothing wrong with that, but when it usurps the worship of God, it's wrong. And until we say, Lord, not in order to get any money, this is not a formula, but Lord, I need you first in my life. I don't know what the future holds. I've got children. I've been in my sister's house. I've been, you know, doing all these things. You know what? I don't know what tomorrow holds, but God does. And we have to always be mindful of the fact that just as we are here today, at peace in God's word, with the hope that God is God of our lives, that he is Jehovah Jireh, that he will provide. He will. And what worthless things do people follow today? Hoping that things could deliver them. Lottery.
Politicians.
You know,
gambling.
TV.
Drugs.
Everything. And anything that receives a higher priority than God in our lives becomes a worthless thing. And our possessions, our jobs, our education, you know, our skills, these may enrich our lives, but they can't deliver us. Oh, you know what? You have teenagers. I mean, there's so many dents on my kid's car, and I'm thinking, you don't drive well. Really? And in turning from worthless things, and there's going to be a deliverance. In turning from worthless things, Samuel called on the people to follow and worship God. That's all he was saying. Even though you've asked for something bad, and now you're stuck with this, that king thing is not such a bad thing. Because now it's going to delineate to the rest of the world what's right and wrong. And in the end, only our relationship with God remains. We should invest wisely in that relationship.
Amen.
And what did the people beg Samuel to do? Yeah! And what words of hope did Samuel offer? The Israelites pleaded with Samuel to pray for their protection. You know what? They knew in their hearts the only thing that could touch the heart of God when you're praying. He says, if you pray anything according to my will, I hear you. And if I hear you, you know that I have petitions that you've asked for. And even though the Israelites had sinned and asked for a king, they could still choose to follow God and worship him. We have presidents. You know, today, we should pray for our president, but we should choose to follow God no matter what. And Samuel promised the people God would not abandon them. He promised. And everything that was written in scriptures was written to give us an encouragement and a hope, like we read in Romans 15:4. And God is unchanged, still full of mercy and grace today. We can count on his faithfulness and his promises. So here's the summary. I was going to show you a video of a president who is putting down the Bible. And I'm sure some of you have seen that. And when you do that, and people listen to you, you become far away. You start stepping away from that. Oh, he was taking things out of context. But, oh, and this is the one that's going to be our president and became a president. Oh. And if he's not for that, and he lights up the White House in rainbow colors,
it must be okay. Because people stop going to church, they stop praying, and it's happening, folks. We are in, like Dr. Stanley says, a crisis. Yes, what?
Yes.
Yes, love everybody as yourself. And here's another commandment. Trust Jesus Christ, who is the new covenant.
The question is, where isn't it in crisis?
Say what?
Where isn't it in crisis?
Right in this room right now.
Yeah, but I meant...
No. And in that classroom, and in that classroom, and in that classroom, and like Dr. Stanley says,
Gathered in my name, I'm in the midst of them.
You know what? And the more you teach other people, the more you go to local missions, like to that apartment complex that we talked about, that Kathleen was talking about, now you're teaching them. And these things entrust to faithful men so they will be able to teach others also. And then there becomes an evangelism explosion.
I just meant countrywide.
Countrywide, there's, you know what? There's nothing new under the sun. People are doing their thing. But there's always hope.
Yes.
Well, in our church here, why isn't there anything to where people can, there a place be picked and people sign up to go for Indian revival?
Like, we're, believe me, we have people like Naresh Malhotra, who is leading thousands of people to the Lord. Mm-hmm. We go on mission trips. We join our career missionaries. It is happening out of this church, and that's why I believe God is blessing
this church. The thing is, you see on the news
here in America.
I see what she's saying.
You see on City Beach Network, which is this organization I'm involved with, Pittsburgh, had a vision where they did this out in Park Church, to pay 100 churches in 10 years. They do 100 churches in 5.
Wow.
See, these are things, though, that like say, I don't know about and I don't see about. I want to be on the news. I want to make the headlines.
Oh, it's in the wait. The right-wing media is never going to show those things on the news. All they want people to know is the church is on the decline. And Dr. Stanley pointed out, you know how many home churches there is in China? And this and that. And it is growing. And people are coming to know the Lord in droves.
What I'm saying is it's quiet.
It is
in
quiet.
Okay, it's too quiet. It's too quiet, in my opinion. I mean, there's one thing in showing. There's one thing in showing love and patience and being submissive. And you can be all of those things, but you can stand for who you are in Him, and you can do it in the right way. And when I turn on the news or read an article, I'm reading about all these parades with gay or transgender, oh, pick your thing, or politics, whatever it is, and they make the headlines, we're upset, but what are we doing as a whole? We're out there. Why aren't we representing?
They're not going to show us on TV.
Hey, you're right. But you know what? The Word of God, like we're studying today,
one-sided media,
is making it erupt in all of us.
Well, then I have a question. Yeah. When Dr. Stanley is saying, get up, stand up.
Yeah.
Stand up, make it up, stand up.
Yeah.
Is he saying then that we should go quietly and do our thing individually, or maybe in a small group kind of
everything.
Thing? Or
everything.
Or
get out of
this. We got local missions going on. We're doing it together. We praise the Lord. Nothing to do with Chris and I or anything, but we've had more people this year go out on the streets, and that's just in one place. We just picked four corners because it's kind of international.
Right.
But 35 people showing up at one time. And that's good, even though it's a big church.
I know.
This is not everybody's thing. Like,
right, well, we witness differently.
Yeah,
everybody,
we do.
If
your workplace, in your homes, around the streets, around the world.
In a
supermarket.
No.
And you don't get people that had their children out there with that flag, and they promised, we as Christians, we need to get together as a group.
Exactly.
And we need the Ten Commandments.
Amen.
Amen. So we can go save our
children. But you know what? When Dr. Stanley said, they used to recite the Ten Commandments, all that. This is what we do in Way of the Master. You know?
And I think the church here.
A lot sent out something last night about this. I can't remember the gentleman's name. He's a pastor, I think. But he was getting people together, even on Facebook, to pray because it was the most holy day of Ramadan.
Yeah.
And he said, this is when Christ usually shows himself. He'll come to Muslims in dreams and visions and things. And he said, so pray that these people will God will come to them and reveal himself. You know, we need to do what God tells us to do. We need to ask God, what do you want us to do today?
And, you know, and after this class, don't go out and don't even get sucked up in the world system. I mean, have good time in 4th of July and stuff, not that type of stuff. But you know what? When something is pulling you that you don't need to go to, don't. Be like these people who were repentant.
I just think that it's important in the midst of everything that's going on that when we are speaking those who are constantly living a life of sin, that they wholeheartedly understand that we are coming to them from a place of love.
Yes. Yeah.
And that, as she stated earlier, that it's not them that we don't love, it's the sin that we don't love. And I think that sometimes that part is what gets lost in the message, and that is what hinders the process in which it is that we're trying to convey. Although I think as long as we come in that type of perspective, it'll be easier for them to receive it.
Okay. I think that we need it. We don't care about a lot of people. So pray, go in fasting and pray, and see the Lord, and if the Lord has way to
the church is sleeping.
It is.
The church need a way.
That's what Paul is revival. Revival is not for the unsaved, it's for the church.
Yeah. Because remember,
revive me, O Lord, according to your word. What does your word say? Now let me do it.
Remember that we have the power, you know?
Yes, we do.
God said, give unto your power and at the feet and seats.
Yep.
Over all the powers of the enemy.
Yeah.
But it's like they allow the devil to cripple us with fear, even myself.
Mm-hmm.
We are so fearful.
Mm-hmm.
You may have few boys want to go there, and some of us are so fearful.
Right.
When you watch you go your weakness, take parents and we are living here. Remember sins. There is a house front in our home. And there are unsafe people here. And it's like the Lord being showing, speaking to my heart over there when they are here. And speak to them, tell them about weakness to them. And I really, and yesterday, when I was coming in, when I look over there, some people were witness at the door, and the Lord said to me, you see here, I've been telling you we have the truth, and you don't go and see other people go. They are more bold than us. Don't matter if you throw up on them. They're still coming back at your door and knocking.
And if unbelievers could do that, imagine what believers could do.
Yeah, but we are so fearful.
We are soft.
And as somebody shows little funny people,
they're
trying our
hands. Lord, make me bold as a lion.
Yeah, yeah, we have the Lord to give us that
spirit. Yes.
Boldness.
Yes, this is so awesome. I want to piggyback on what she said. I just talked to a man at the bus station.
Did y'all hear her?
No.
Okay.
And very man, and the very same thing that she just said, he was, I think he was Muslim. And he talked about
Ramadan.
I had no idea what he was talking about. I wasn't trying to turn them ill, but I couldn't understand where he was coming from. And he was trying to tell me something.
Yeah, it's like Yom Kippur in their Jewish religion.
Yeah.
It's a holiday. It's a religious, a holy day.
It had to have some life. It's just been confirmed. I mean, I know we all have different beliefs and stuff like that, but come on.
God will use all of that.
Come on, y'all.
That's the thing. We all have different beliefs.
Yes.
And we're supposed to come together and have the one true belief.
You know how the games a lot
if
of
this was Jewish, everybody would be talking at once.
I mean, why can't we call a day where we're going to female park?
Amen.
And we're going to pray. And we don't even have to make it complicated. Get the word out. and invite other churches. Let's have a prayer day and be loud part about these issues. I think we
well, you, well, you can get, you can get even online. There's prayer, even through texting, even through this and that, on the phones.
Social media, all kinds of things. Put the word out, just do it.
Well, if the
somebody do it.
If God's leading you to do it, then organize.
Yeah.
Come on, Paul, I'm down.
Yeah, we got
it. Yeah, yeah.
No,
down,
right. Paul. Okay, that's 38 different ministries. So we're down for
okay.
Yeah. Yes.
She
is.
So I would say you and somebody else.
No, I would love to do it.
I'm saying, I'm saying you're passionate about it. You know somebody that's a Christian that believes the way take them to the park. Start out that way. Start out small. Don't necessarily just look at another church because you are the church.
You and even if it starts out small and grows, this is some of the best.
Then I want to also say this. We're talking about Ramadan. This church stands out to me as one of the better churches because there's so much information around. We're talking about Ramadan. I don't even know where I picked the flyer up or the brochure up, but I picked it up here last week talking about Ramadan. And to be praying for it. I don't know where I picked it up, but it's here. I don't even remember where I picked the brochure up, but it's around. This place, like Pastor Stanley says, is like a little city. Explore the city and the church. You'll find different things that will help you in your ministry and help you in your walk with God. She was talking about the Ramadan and everything. When she mentioned, I was like, well, I picked up a brochure from somewhere here in the church. And I had it at home. I looked at it later. I was like, well, they have different days for Ramadan that we should pray for. And it's talking about the church growing through the Muslim, or people being converted from the Muslim faith to Christianity. But it's here. It's just a matter of us focusing on what God is telling us by the Spirit.
And He'll lead us where we need to go. Where He wants us to go.
And this is what the book of Samuel is talking about.
I got 1 minute.
Samuel was living his life just like God wanted. He was living his life, I would say, like in a fishbowl. He wasn't trying to go into the world to be rich. We go back what he said. He didn't try to, you know, have opportunity to be rich, but he lived his life like the Lord. And he set an example. He was saying that the Lord have not forsaken, have not left him. He will not leave you when we stand up for the Lord.
That's right. Yeah. Okay, well, I'm just going to finish this off and then.
Are you going to show the video?
I love this class. What?
Are you going to show the video and wait 20 minutes?
I'll just show the video.
Of which one?
Of the president.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Okay. I'll finish this and then show it and anybody wants to say the video. And I don't want to, when I do show it, I don't want to just belittle the president. I just want to say, this is what happens little by little, okay? Where have you seen examples of God faithfulness in your life and in the life of your family? Okay, just think about this. How can we show our gratitude for God for His grace and mercy? Recall the ways you've seen God through your family life in detail. Big and small, remembering God's faithfulness in the past gives us courage and strength to face the challenges of today. We honor God and show our gratitude in ways we live. Hebrews 13 reminds us that we should have a sacrifice of praise to Him. And this is the personal challenge. Approach your worship of God this week with fresh eyes, with an attitude of respect, reverence, and awe. If it feels like the same old casual routine, then what steps can you take to worship in a way that truly honors God? Now, when I say worship, it's not just, you know, not just that. We worship God as living sacrifices, and we do things. And so get involved with, you know, local missions or wherever you're planted. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, Your word is powerful. You've written about it, and this was just history, about what happened to the first king of Israel. And there were good kings and there were bad kings. And bad kings didn't follow You, the good kings did. And Lord, all those intricacies with King David and Solomon and all those, Rehoboam and all those different types of kings, You were faithful to Your word that You were going to bless those who bless You and curse those who curse Israel and all of that. Your word is truth. Just even in today, in today's lesson and in this classroom, people's hearts are stirred and they want to follow You. And this is what Your word does. It gives us an encouragement and a hope, and that's why they were written in there for us.
to benefit from. So Lord, take this word, keep it in the hearts of your people so that they would do something to honor you and have awe and reverence and respect. We love you, and it's Christ's holy, precious name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.